Hello, I'm Rebecca, and I'm here today with Chantel Helm, who is on the learning team at the Cambridge University Botanic Gardens. And you're here to talk to me about an upcoming event for the Cambridge Festival. What's the event called and what's it about?
Well, it's all about finding wild plant ingredients in your everyday products. We've got a little selection here. we're all using wild plants, whether we know it or not. And the event is to really sort of get everybody thinking and looking at their everyday products, maybe their things that they're using in the bathroom, things they're using in the kitchen, and to see in that ingredient list what is collected from the wild as a plant.
Great. And what day is that going to be?
The event runs from the 31st of March to the 10th of April. We will have a little stand in the glass houses, the Botanic Garden.
Yep.
And you can come along and visit the stand and learn all about the different plants that are involved, how they are collected, and get a little bit of an insight into wild collection and why that's an interesting thing and why potentially a difficult thing for us to talk about, because sometimes those plants that are used in our everyday products are not harvested sustainably, or the people who are harvesting them are not given a fair price for their collection in the wild.
Right, well, on that note, let's have a look at some of the products that you've got for us today. So what are we looking at here, and what's the good and what's the bad?
Well, there's no bad. We just sort of wanted to highlight the facts. Most people don't realize that plants, wild plants, are used in our products. So we're just talking about what's there. We've got some licorice. So a lot of licorice around the world is collected wild, grown wild, and then people collect them, especially in Europe. We've got some licorice roots, so you can see what the root looks like. It's a sort of funny thing. And licorice is mostly used in sweets, as we've got here, but also to flavour cigarettes and other things like that quite a lot.
It's quite stinky, the root.
It's stinky.
It doesn't smell like normal licorice. It smells
yeah.
A bit like, I don't know,
horrible licorice.
So this is what it looks like.
That's
growing.
What it looks like as a root, yes, okay. Underground. That's get used and extracted to make the licorice. We've got Brazil nuts that everybody knows about. You will not be, may not know that all Brazil nuts that we get are from wild trees in South America, collected from the forests, the rainforests there. So the Brazil nut trees are actually threatened with extinction. They're vulnerable. And obviously with deforestation, that is threatening the supply of Brazil nuts. So next time you eat a Brazil nut, have a think about that. And then in everyday products, so your shampoos, you've got argan oil potentially, and shea butter is another big one that you'll find in lots of creams and things in your bathroom maybe. Here is an example of what the shea butter actually looks like. It's all soft and squidgy. It's extracted from the seeds of the fruits of the tree from which shea butter is grown on the tree in the wild.
It's quite fun. It's like,
yes,
a stress relief.
We actually use it quite a lot in chocolate these days, so it replaces cocoa butter quite a lot.
What are the advantages of using shea butter over cocoa?
I think it's more easily available. It's a little bit cheaper, I think. Let's see. But again, so a lot of these things are part of what we're calling the wild dozen. So these are the 12 products, or 12 ingredients that have been highlighted by Traffic, which is the organization that looks at the trade of endangered species. And obviously we trade in animals, which is quite well known, and there's a lot of trafficking of animals, but we're not very well known about trafficking of plants. Mm-hmm. So they're looking at the trade in that. And these wild dozen is the big five, or the big 12 ingredients, the flagship ingredients that talks about wild plants. So it's not all bad. A lot of it is good collected in the wild. What is interesting is just we want to understand that trade, how much of the plant is collected, and how is that impacting on the natural population, and how are those people who are collecting the ingredients treated? Are they getting a fair price? And therefore there's new standards and certifications that are coming in. Things like fair trade is one thing that's more linked to things that are actually grown and cultivated.
Mm.
And there's a new standard called Fair Wild, which is looking at the wild plants that are collected.
So it's not necessarily a bad thing for something to be collected from the wild, as long as it's done in a sustainable way and a way that's fair for everyone involved.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. And I think the real key message is to appreciate that a lot of the products we have got wild plant ingredients, and to think a little bit about when you're buying that product, how has the ingredient gotten into that product? Is it fairly done? And could it be certified in some way? Various standards that are out there. So if you're looking in your cupboard next time, we're really going to challenge you to have a look. The event is all about challenging you to have a look at your products. And if you find a wild plant ingredient in the ingredients list for any of your products, then go to Twitter. We've got I found wild as the hashtag, and let us know with a photograph. So hopefully we can flood that Twitter handle with lots and lots of pictures of products with wild ingredients.
I found some licorice.
Yep, perfect.
The pumpkin tea. So I found wild.
You found
so
wild.
I need to take a photo and then upload it to Twitter with hashtag I found wild.
Exactly.
That's correct. Okay, good. Awesome. Well, I can tell you already that I will be looking in. I get through a lot of tea and a lot of shampoo, so that will be where I'll be looking in my house. Less licorice.
You're not a licorice fan. Oh well.
But yeah, thank you so much, Chantel. This is really interesting, and I've never thought of it before. I always assume that all the plants we use in our products have been farmed or cultivated in some way. So it's really eye opening. And maybe now you can show us: are there any of these products? Are there any of these plants that get into these products in the glasshouses?
So we've got a few which we will be showcasing during the actual event, but we can go and have a look at one, the baobab, like that.